Okay. Hello everyone. I hope you all are doing great. And for today's session, we would be discussing about building operators like a ninja with Kubernetes operators. So let me just share my screen. Okay, is my screen visible? Okay, cool. So this is the topic for today, Under the Light. And myself, my name is Avni Sharma, and I am a software engineer at Red Hat. And my day-to-day work revolves around Kubernetes, OpenShift, and operators. I work in the developer tools team in OpenShift. And along with me, I have my colleague Akash, who is a software engineer as well. And we both together work together in the same project. So what is our goal here with the talk today? So our goal here is to help you all to build your very first operator. So it's a very beginners-oriented session, and we would take you from why we need an operator and when we should plan on adopting to use an operator. And then Akash would be doing a live demo on building your operator. So what are operators? So at the very onset of the talk, I would like to describe that when we say operator, we should visualize a human being who is really adept and who has a very deep knowledge of the systems they are working on, and they know how the systems behave and how to react if there are any problems. So when I say operator, we should think about a human operator who does manual tasks day to day, and that person is really skilled, and he knows the application domain, whatever he is working on. So operator is basically a pattern, and this word was coined by CoreOS. So considering the stateless application scenario in Kubernetes today, so if we consider a typical 12-factor web app, we can perform the following scenarios. So our pods can survive crashes and node failures, which can be done through a replication controller. And we can easily scale it up and down. And we can internally load balance traffic to instances via services. So basically, currently in Kubernetes, the scenario of managing, creating stateless application is really seamless and smooth. But what happens when we have a database? Or let's take it on a very broader spectrum. What happens when we have something stateful? It can be a database, it can be message queues, anything like that. And it can be caches as well, anything which has state oriented to it. And we can have some legit concerns around it. And those concerns can be that instances need to stay with the data, and scaling may not be as simple as we did for stateless applications on Kubernetes. As we all know, that special knowledge would be required to manage the database, and it cannot be rescheduled on any host like stateless services. So it is pretty cumbersome. So for a stateful application, I have considered an example of an etcd database, and it will perform the following four actions. That is, namely, to create, destroy etcd cluster, resize, backup, and upgrade. So on taking a recap of what we had discussed of a human operator image, bringing it down into the Kubernetes world, we can essentially say that an operator extends the Kubernetes API to create, configure, and manage instances of complex state application. Why do we say it's complex state application? Because specific domain application knowledge is encapsulated in it. And we build this operator upon the basic knowledge of Kubernetes resource and controllers. So we would be using the concepts of Kubernetes resource and controllers, and then building our logic for our complex state applications. And this is known as an operator. So now I have divided the definition into three important parts. So the first one is custom resource definitions. So today when we do kubectl or kubectl, as many people call it, we can do kubectl get pods, get deployments, but I want to do kubectl get suppose hello, anything arbitrary, something that I have made and something that is not available in native Kubernetes out of the box. So that is my resource, that is a custom resource. So when I talk about custom resource, I definitely talk about a controller, because once we have our resource, we need certain actions to be held against that resource. And since it is our logic, we call it a custom controller. And of course, the custom controller would have domain knowledge since it is custom. And the domain knowledge can be like installing, cleanup, self-heal, restore, backup, update, anything. So when I say I need a custom resource, it basically means that I need the whole configuration of my resource at one place. I want to mention it in a declarative manner in one YAML, and I want action happening upon that YAML. So before we discuss CRDs, I would like to show how an API request looks like in a native Kubernetes resource. So like I do kubectl get pods, pods is a resource, and a typical API request would look like API slash core slash v1 slash pods. And if I see pods is a resource, v1 is version, and core is group. So to make my custom API request, I would definitely require a group and a version. So there we go. We need to come up with our group, version, and resource names. And this is effectively how we are extending the Kubernetes API that is not necessarily available in a default Kubernetes installation. So as I discussed, we call CRDs as custom resource definitions. And CRD is basically a way to define a format for telling Kubernetes that my custom resource is going to be of this format. So CRD is basically a blueprint, and custom resource would be an instance of that blueprint. So this is a snapshot of a CRD example, and it does not cover the whole YAML file. I've just taken a snap of it. So here, as you can see, I've taken a very arbitrary name, which is hello. And if you see under spec, I have defined my group version, and this is what I have given. It's custom to my needs, and the kind is hello. So like we have kind pod, I have given kind hello. And as you come beneath, you can also see plural and singular. So like you can do kubectl get pods, that is plural. And similarly, I can do kubectl get hellos. And I can register my custom API request in Kubernetes because of this very cool feature, which is known as custom resource definition. If you see the kind in the topmost second line, you can see it's custom resource definition, and it is in V1 beta 1 stage. So this is a typical CRD YAML that would look like. So we have the blueprint, we have the format. We now need to create an instance of that format. So I have my group that I had described earlier, and I have my version. And my CR name, which is my instance name, would be example hello. So now if you see the spec, So spec would specify the desired state of the cluster. This is what I need. And that is what you would define in your instance spec. So just summarizing, we have a CRD, so it is very analogous to doing kubectl get pods. I can do kubectl get hello. And like I have an instance of a pod, suppose example pod, similarly, I can have an instance of hello. So now I have my instance there. I apply it in my cluster, but what happens now? I have applied my instance and there's nothing happening around it. So for that, we need a controller, and that controller has the domain knowledge that we imbibe in it. And this whole scenario is a custom controller. So a custom controller needs a, it means that a custom resource needs a controller to act upon its presence inside the cluster. And such controllers are called custom controllers. So this is the current state of the cluster, and we need to reach to a desired state. That is the whole aim of the controller. So this is a very basic loop that is there in Kubernetes, and it works on these three major steps, which is observe, analyze, and act. So observe means to observe the current state of the cluster. Analyze is to compare the current state to the desired state. Desired state is something that our custom resource defines. I showed you the spec that was according to our custom needs, that I needed of size 3, of city, blah, blah, and name, yada, yada. And once I know what is my current state and where do I need to reach, I can act upon it. Either I can spin up more pods, delete pods, anything. And you see, this is a loop. So over here, what is happening is that whenever there is any CRUD event, whether it's create, whether it is kubectl edit, whether it is kubectl delete, there is an event happening, and this is event driven. This loop is event driven, and that event would then trigger observe, then analyze, and act in a sequential manner. So the events drive this whole loop. And we have a nickname for this, and we would be mentioning the nickname from now on, and it's known as reconcile. So when to opt for an operator? So you should consider these points while thinking that you should you even think of building an operator. So you should go ahead if these points have been ticked against. So either you want application that uses declarative API, you want top level support from kubectl, and you want basic CRUD actions happening on your instances or custom resources, and you need the whole reconcile loop happening, which is typically build automation for watches, and the whole event handling scenario. And that event handling scenario is governed by your business logic that has been encapsulated in your custom controller. While it might seem really tempting to just dive in and build an operator, it can be really challenging because you have to write a lot of boilerplate code from scratch. If you don't have a framework, it can be really tedious. You need to have advanced knowledge of informers, good testing scaffolding, good repo organization, and research related to tools interact with the API. So it can be very cumbersome, intimidating, and we definitely need an easy way to create and manage operators. So you might think it's time to freak out, but sit, hold in tight, and we have a solution for that. And that is effectively Operator Framework, which is an open source project. An operator framework has three important parts, which is Operator SDK, Operator Lifecycle Manager, and Operator Metering. So we would be touching upon Operator SDK, and Operator SDK is it's a framework which lets you build your operator, and it is really easy to use Operator SDK. So today we would be concentrating just on billing an operator, and OLM or Operator Lifecycle Manager is a way to distribute your operators and manage the lifecycle of it. So like install, upgrade, update, all of that is governed by OLM. And operator metering is related to metrics, and we won't be touching these two. You can also refer the link that has been mentioned here in the slide. So while building an operator, we come across Operator SDK, and within Operator SDK, we can actually develop operators via three ways, which is Go, Ansible, and Helm. For today, we would be going through building operators with Go. So this is the demo workflow. Over here, I'm concentrating on the reconcile logic. Excuse me. So first we have observe, where we are watching over API requests. And this is my custom resource. I apply it. And once I have applied it, it's there in the cluster. I'm analyzing it now. So I'm checking the size and the version mentioned in the spec in my custom resource, which is my desired state. So current size, currently I have nothing in the cluster. So current size, current version is none. Desired count is 3. Desired version is also mentioned. So now I see that current size, since I have nothing, it's less than the desired size, and current version is not equal to my desired version. So I've analyzed it, now I act upon it. So I can either scale up pods depending upon the size, scale down, change image tags. An advanced custom logic would be to have each pod in a separate node. So this is all custom logic. You can act however you feel like. So the other thing can be kubectl edit, kubectl delete. So all of these events would eventually re-trigger these steps. So that is how the reconcile loop works. So it's demo time, and I would like to hand over the baton to Akash now.
Hi everyone. So Avni has given us the theoretical knowledge about how we can use Operator SDK to perform the automation on our cluster. So in this demo, what we are going to do is we are going to create one sample etcd operator. So what this operator would do, this would help us to create to deploy etcd cluster on our Kubernetes. Inside our Kubernetes cluster, we can scale up, we can scale down, and we can also destroy the cluster if you want. So all these operations can be performed using operator itself. So let's go ahead and start the operator. So first thing is we need to create a repo. We need to have a scaffolding. So Operator SDK provides a way. So this is Operator SDK, and I have, you can see Operator SDK installed. Okay, so we need to do Operator SDK new. So this is a command to create a new operator. So we need to pass few arguments. One of them is the operator name. The other one is the repo URL. So this is where we actually provide our GitHub repo link so that the import path would be aligned. So let's go ahead and create the operator. Okay, I already have it, so I'll just delete it. And then I'll create it again using the same command. So you should see it has already it's been creating some files, Go files, some set of files which are required to run an operator. So we can go ahead and cd into that. Okay, so I can show you the tree. So here you can see it has already created nine different directories. Some are related to the build, some are related to the, it has some YAML files which are required for Kubernetes to set up our operator, and some Go files. So right now we can see we don't have anything inside our package directory, just empty APIs file, and we don't have anything in our controller as well. So first thing, as Avni mentioned, that we need to have our custom resource defined in our Kubernetes cluster. So how we can do that? We need to do operator SDK. We need to add. There is another command called add, and we can provide the API. And this is where we need to pass kind. Kind is nothing but the name of the custom resource, the way we have in our Kubernetes, like pod deployment or replica set. So something like that, we are creating our custom resource with this name, and we are providing some version groups. As soon as we do that, it's going to create another couple of files. Let's go ahead, and we can see it has already created some files under the package directory and the deploy directory. So let's go ahead and see the package directory. So here we can see it has created this version and the HCD types, the Go equivalent of the custom resource which we are going to create. So right now we have an API, but now we need a custom controller which acts based on the changes which we do on that on the CR. So basically, if we create a CR, if we update a CR, or maybe if we delete the CR, our controller should get triggered. So right now we don't have any controller defined. So let's go ahead and create a controller. So to create a controller, again, we need to add controller. And to this, we need to pass a parameters. And the parameters are the kind, the same one which we passed in the previous command. So this is where we pass the we say that we want to watch this particular resource in our Kubernetes cluster which has this version. So operator SDK is going to generate a controller code base for us which already watches these resources. Okay, so here we can see it has already created some controller files with some boilerplate code. So right now I'll not go into this created files, because we still have to add our custom business logic to it, and we also have to define our CR spec. So in our CR here, you can see in the notes here, our CR will look something similar to this, which I have here. It has a spec, size, and the version. So size is basically the number of pods we want to have for that HCD cluster. And this is the version, and this version is nothing but the HCD version which will get create the pod will get created with this HCD version. So as soon as we create this CR, we should have HCD cluster ready with this number of pods. So what we are going to do in the controller custom logic, the custom controller, we are going to create deployment based on the CR metadata values. So I'll just go ahead and open up the already created operator here, and I'll open it. I can show you guys the code base. So first I'll go over the, so these are the directories which got generated by operator SDK. So first thing I'll go into the APIs, and we'll see the API here. Okay. Yeah, so this is the API struct which we created. So in the spec, I've already defined size and value. So we want these two metadata inside our spec field. So whenever we create this CR, this field will get automatically mapped to the HCD, this particular Go struct, so that it will be easier for our controller to fetch the values and build a deployment YAML based on the values we provided in the CR. And also we have something called status. So status is something it will return the status of the current CR. So whenever we create a CR, our controller will perform some operation, and as output we should know that whether there are any errors or what is the status of that particular CR operation. So this is something API will look like. After that, I'll just go ahead and show you guys the code of controller itself. Yeah, so this is the code. So most of the code is auto generated. So only the thing is, first thing is we need to watch particular resource. So that has been done in the add function here. Here we can see it watches this particular resource, and we can pass some kind of predicates whether we want to perform, we want to trigger reconcile loop on create or on delete or some update fields. So that's up to us. So this watch is completely customizable. After that, so whenever there are some changes detected by the operator, it triggers the reconcile loop. So this is the main backbone of custom controller. We receive a CR in the reconcile function, and we can perform a business logic what we want. So in our example, we want to have a deployments created for this specified size and versions. That's what we are doing here. If you see, I'll just go ahead directly head to the code where we created deployments. So this function will internally get called somewhere in the reconcile loop. I'll just go ahead and see the create. Yeah, so this deployment. So what we do is we simply create one deployment YAML equivalent go struct here. And here two values we are going to define specifically. The one is the size. So here instance is nothing but the CR, which we get, which we pass here to this function, and we read the size value. Size is nothing but the pod size. And another one is we need to have a proper HCD image to deploy. So this is something I'm getting the image, HCD image from Bitnami HCD repo, and I'm replacing the instance version. So this is, so whenever we pass like in this CR, we can see 3.4.9. So it's going to pull the image of Bitnami HCD 3.4.9. So this is how it will do, it will work. And in reconcile, we will create this, we have extra business logic to perform what to do when there is an update, what to do when there is a deletion. So in case of deletion, we'll simply delete the deployment, and in case of update, we'll simply patch the deployment. Okay, so this is all about the controller. Now let's we can now run this operator. To run this operator locally, we'll first make sure that our kubectl is pointing to the correct cluster. So I'll just check if my nodes are up. Yeah, so right now I have a 1.18.2 Kubernetes cluster. To run the operator inside that cluster, we need to do operator SDK run and local. So what this will do, this will basically start a process, start a Go process, and the client Go will basically be pointing to the kubectl configs. Let's go ahead and start. But before starting this, we need to make sure that we have CRDs registered, because our cluster have no idea about HCD cluster CR. So we can see inside the deploy in CRDs, we have this particular YAML file generated by operator SDK. It contains all the schema about our CRD, what fields we have, then the open schema validation, everything will be inside that. So we need to go ahead and create this CRD. So now it has been registered. We can see the created. Now I'll just go ahead to the root and I'll do the operator SDK run local. Yeah, so this is around running the operator in our cluster. So we should able to perform any operation which we just discussed, like creation of cluster, managing the cluster. I'll just go into the directory. Okay. So right now we already have an example here. I'll show you guys the example of this CR example. So what it has, it specifies the EPA version kind. It's just an ordinary YAML, Kubernetes YAML. But here we have the kind as HCD cluster, and these two specific specs which we defined in our API, so which one of them is size and version. So we have already specified the default value as 3, and this is the etcd version we want to have a cluster with. We can simply go ahead. So before that, I'll just watch here the Kubernetes deployments, because we should see that deployments are up, the size and everything we can see here. So if you do this, so right now we don't have any resources. So let's go ahead and create this example CR. Okay. So here we can see our reconcile loop got triggered as soon as we created this this CR with the etcd API. And here we can see it has already created a deployment file, and we can see right now the image should be pulling up. Yeah, so we can also see the pods. Yeah, the container is creating. So here we can see. So right now what we have done is we have created a CR, the simple CR. Simple CR with the particular metadata, and it has created a etcd cluster for us with that particular version. So let's say now we want to scale up the cluster, because we don't want only 3 nodes, we want 5 nodes to be running for this cluster. So all we need to do is we just need to edit that this particular CR. So how we can do is we can do kubectl edit, then etcd clusters and the name. So I'll just set my editor first, kube editor, so it'll be easier to edit. So I'll just go down straight to the spec field. Now I don't want 3, I want, let's say, 6, and I'll save the file. Internally it'll do kubectl apply. We should see, we see the reconcile loop has been triggered, and also the deployment size has been changed. So it's easier to scale up or scale down. So similar way, we can scale it down back to the 3 again. I'll head to the size, instead of 6, let's have 3 only. We just apply it, internally it will apply, it will patch that YAML, and we can see the deployment has been changed to 3. Now we no longer want, let's say we no longer want our cluster. So all we need to do is we just need to delete a CR. So now whenever we delete a CR, the deployment will also will get deleted, because we have set the owner reference of this deployment config to the CR which we created. So as soon as we delete the CR, all the dependent resources will get cleared up from the cluster. Let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to delete etcd clusters and the example cluster, etcd cluster which we created. See, here you can see the deployment is gone, so our cluster is clean now. So this is how we can use Operator SDK to manage you know, small application or any complex application. It's up to us, up to the business. So we can have as much as complex business logic inside our reconcile loop or inside our custom controller. Yeah, this is all about the demo. So Avni will just now give us a recap of what we did here. So back to you, Avni.
I hope my slides are visible. Yeah, so a quick demo recap. We have less time, so I will just rush through it. So that we can take questions. So what we did with Operator SDK was we got an awesome boilerplate code. The other thing that we saw Akash doing was to mention the spec that is in the CR in a Golang format, and we can see it's very well mentioned etcd cluster spec. And it is just that it is so easy to locate where to add, and similarly the status part can be added there as well. And this is the types.go file, so defining APIs is also pretty easy now. And the other thing is defining custom logic in reconcile function. We have the etcd cluster controller.go file under controller etcd cluster. So we have it's like our life is sorted now. Everything with one framework and in a very seamless manner. So I would just like to mention Operator Hub, which is like an app store of operators. It's a registry where even you all can contribute your operator or use any available operator, which is already built there and it's out there in the community. And Operator Hub can be installed in any Kubernetes cluster. So this is Operator Hub installed in OpenShift, and you can see that there is an operator here, for example, a service binding operator. You just click on it and you click install, and there you go. That's your operator there up and running in the cluster. So at the end of the presentation, I have mentioned some links in the PDF, and it would be there on the SCED as well. I have uploaded the presentation, so you all can take a look at all these relevant references. And under demo example, you would find the example that Akash ran, the HCT demo operator, and you all can ask questions there via issues or drop us an email, and you can just take a look at the example. And there's a community support around it. You can visit Kubernetes Workspace and Kubernetes Operators channel, or you can hang out in Google group, discuss, and get your questions clarified as well. So this is amazing. Now we can all build our own operator. How cool is that? So thank you all for attending today's session, and we're open to questions. And while we're taking questions, I would urge you all to scan this QR code, drop us a feedback and any questions that you feel that were not answered, because we're running short of time. So yeah, that was it. Yeah. Yeah. Sure. Any questions?
Yeah, I think we have a couple of questions in the chat itself. So so operator is demoed locally, and the client go is basically pointing to the remote Kubernetes cluster. So yeah, it's not actually entirely deployed on the Kubernetes cluster. If you want to deploy, there is a way. Operator SDK provides a way to put that whole operator in the Docker image and then deploy it. Or there is something called Operator Hub, where you can, it's a kind of marketplace for operators. You can have your operator and on the Operator Hub, and then you can basically install it on any cluster. Are there any plans to support other languages in the Operator SDK besides Go? I think that there are, I don't think so. So so right now we support Go entirely because all the Kubernetes ecosystem uses the Go. So we have all the dependent packages, and it's very easy to write operator because most of the code is already been written. But I think there are a couple of open source projects. They're still trying to make use of the controller runtimes to have it in different languages. I think Python is one of them, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah, just to add to that, I have come across Python client libraries, like we have client Go and some Java client libraries. So there are client libraries there to make custom controllers. However, I'm not sure about any framework around it. We do have client libraries. So you won't be deadlocked that due to any language constraints. You can still go ahead, but I'm not sure about the framework being built around it.
Also, we have a way to have the operator with the helm But again, Helm, using Helm, we can only create different resources, but having the business logic is kind of difficult using Helm. So Go is the better way if you want to write operator. What are your use cases for using an operator? So in Red Hat, we basically have Dev Console operator. We have a couple of operators. So all the functionality which are required to be inside the OpenShift cluster, we have an operator for that. For example, we have something called Dev Console where we can just provide a Git URL. And as soon as we provide a Git URL, our code should get deployed without any issue. So it should get compiled, the images should get built and deployed to the where or any other Docker registry. And everything should work seamlessly. So that is something we are working on in Red Hat. And there are a couple
Yeah.
of
We also have
projects.
a service binding operator. I was currently working on that. And so what a service binding operator does is that it takes applications and services. Services can be any backing service, any DB or any Kafka, anything. And it connects your application with that particular backing service, and you would not come to know about it. So that is something that happens in the background, and that's an operator use case that we are catering to. And yeah, you can explore it on Operator Hub as well.
Yeah, and I to the Avni, I can add a few more points about service binding operator. So you can basically connect to different applications in Kubernetes without doing any extra configuration. Like if you are like etcd cluster, and if you are another Node.js application which uses etcd cluster, you just have to create deployments for these two different applications or database and the application. And then just create a service binding CR, specify that you want to connect this etcd cluster to this Node.js application. And our service binding operator would basically handle that. It would figure out all the required metadata such as host URL, username, password, and it will bind it into the Node.js pod. So that is the use case we have. If
I
there's
guess
more.
my slides were not shared in the my screen was not shared in the end, so you all can take a look at the PPT again. I have uploaded it in shared as well.
Yeah. Okay. So
Yeah.
there's one more unanswered question. How does the status help in your reconciler? So right now, I think I did not show you the status. So in status, when everything goes right, we just print the message that the etcd cluster has been deployed with this number of pods or number of nodes and with this etcd cluster version. And if it fails, we just append the error so that it's easier to debug as a Kubernetes admin.
Right. And we have another question. Is your operator demoed running locally or within the KTS cluster?
Sorry, which
It
one?
says, is your operator demoed running locally or within the Kubernetes cluster?
I did answer that, so I'll repeat that again. So basically, operator is running locally using the Go process, so it's demoed entirely on locally. But when we run the operator code, it actually connects to the remote Kubernetes cluster using the kubeconfig file or any auth mechanism which we have in our cluster, in our local setup, in our local system. There's one more. Why do you choose to create an operator? So we basically work on the most of the Kubernetes or containerization applications, and there should be, I think there should be a proper way to automate such a process, because since Kubernetes is expanding more and more, we need to have a proper mechanism to have our custom application to be deployed in Kubernetes. And we should, with the custom controller, we have entire control in our hand. We can actually see the each life. We can actually control the life cycle of the CR. I think that is something is very important when we build a Kubernetes application. So I think Operator SDK provides a bit of scaffolding. It has a great support, and you can do a lot of things with these. With few commands, you get the API code generated, controller code generated. So I think that is the reason we choose to create an operator.
Yeah, I mean, if I can elaborate on that, suppose in case of any sharded database, suppose I know that I want to do sharding on my database, and I want certain parts of my database in one node and the other in another, and that is something that I know, and nobody else will come and shard my database. That is something really niche and something that only I operate. So I would make such a custom logic that I put, you know, that I shard database on particular nodes that I know where to, in a set manner, and certain manual exercises, you know, like I want to do SSH to a server after this event happens or something, anything that you do manually, and you would be knowing it because you operate it. And something that you think you operate it on a daily basis and can be automated, you should go forward with an operator. I mean, of course, if you have a very good configuration file, a very good secret or config map, you have the configuration is set. You can have stateful sets as well, but then it becomes a whole orchestra of services, stateful sets, PVC volumes, but I want the whole configuration in one YAML, and I want to make it really convenient for me that I want this database and this stateful set and everything, the whole configuration, the whole desired state is at one place. It becomes really easy. I guess that's it. And if you all have any other questions, you all can reach out to us on Slack or Twitter. Yeah.
Thank you everyone for
Yeah.
joining.